Welcome to chapter 7. So in this chapter, we'll discuss more about synchronization. Specifically, we will use all the primitives that we have learnt in chapter 6, and we will use them to create more real world use cases. So that's the main aim, that we'll use it to create more of real world use cases that can be used to solve practical problems of interest. So what will we study? We'll discuss the bounded buffers problem that is used to primarily communicate between processes as well as between a process and the kernel. Then the readers writers problem, which again is very important, particularly when we have many readers and many writers for the same queue. The dining philosopher and the family of dining philosopher problems are very important as far as deadlocks are concerned. Then a little bit of Linux, Windows and Java. So we always have that, right? You have been seeing it in these lectures. So you can also look at it in the original Silverschatz, Galvin and Gans book. There's a lot of real world examples from the most popular platforms. So what are the classical problems? These three in the world of synchronization, bounded buffer, readers, writers and dining philosophers. All of these problems can be solved using the primitives that we have learnt in the previous lecture, which was for chapter 6. So the bounded buffer problem is pretty simple. So we have n buffers, but each buffer can hold one item. So where and when is it used? So it is used, for example, to communicate between processes. So let's say we have process 1 and we have process 2. Okay. So in this case, what we can do is we can have a buffer where it has a, so every buffer in practice has to have a bound. Otherwise, we will see in the security chapter that it will lead to a major security issue, which is not desirable. And that's the reason every buffer should have a bound on the number of, so every array should have, or a queue should have, let's say a bound, let's say n buffers, such that both processes can use it to communicate, as well as this can be used to communicate between the process and the kernel, as well as between kernel threads. So what we have a semaphore called mutex, a semaphore called full, and a semaphore called empty. So empty is initialized to n because at the beginning n buffers are empty. Full is initialized to 0 and mutex is initialized to 1. We will see what they mean, but essentially mutex being initialized to 1 essentially means that the buffer, the code to access the buffer is free, in the sense nobody has taken the lock. So then we'll have a producer and a consumer, a producer process and a consumer process. So the structure of the producer process will look something like this. So we produce an item. So it is in next produced. You first wait on empty. See, wait till one of the buffers is empty. That is required. After that, once a buffer is free, which means that if there are n buffers at the beginning which were empty, after this wait, it will become n minus 1. And then you wait on the mutex. So you wait on the mutex primarily because the buffer is a shared structure. And as of now, the only algorithm that we know is not thread safe, so only a single processor can add something to a queue. So of course there are variants which are known as lock free and wait free queues, where multiple processors can access a queue and add their items. So they would use the atomic primitives like compare and set or test and set, but we are not in a position to appreciate that, so that's taught in a separate course. But at the moment, to do anything with the queue of buffers that is, we need to have a lock and unlock, which is a wait and signal mechanism that we have seen in the previous chapter. We wait on the mutex. Then after that, once it is done, we do a signal. So wait and signal. And finally, when something has been added, we signal full. So which means that if any other process is waiting on the buffer, then it will know that look, something has been added. So the full semaphore is signaled. So we will discuss that when we discuss more about full, when we discuss the consumer. Now the consumer process, this is how it looks. It waits on full. So essentially it waits till there is at least one item in the buffer. And given the fact that after adding an item, the producer signals, the consumer will find the signal and it will wake up. This part of the code is the same, between the wake mutex and the signal mutex, where we'll remove an item from the buffer to be consumed. And of course, full and empty are being used in a reverse connotation over here. So we wait on full because if you are consuming, we don't want the queue of buffers to be empty. So we wait till at least there is one item such that it can be consumed. And after doing that, we signal empty. Empty basically says that look, one item has been consumed. So that's the reason we'll let empty know that increment the number of free buffers, the number of empty buffers. So if you see the order is wait empty, wait mute, wait empty, signal full. Here it is wait full and signal empty, the reverse. So basically every time we want the production and consumption to be paired, which is what you are seeing. So this is a pretty simple mechanism of ensuring synchronization across two processes, particularly when one is, we have a bounded buffer. And whenever I read, I want at least one full item, one produced item in the buffer. And whenever I produce, I don't want to exceed the bound, which is n entries. All right. So now let us look at something similar, the readers writers problem, but this is different in the sense we have two kinds of processes. One is a reader, and the reader's job is to only read. So it does not perform any updates, it does not perform any writes, it only reads. And a writer can both read as well as write. So the problem is that to enhance parallelism, instead of protecting the entire code by one lock that accesses the queue. So incidentally here monitors are also very useful, because if let's say the queue has several functions, let's say NQ, DQ, is empty, full and so on. So we can protect all of them by a monitor. So this will ensure that if one of the functions is being used, another function cannot be used by another process. But what we will do is, this is inefficient primarily because multiple readers can read at the same time. They are not modifying the data. They are not making conflicting accesses. Consequently, multiple readers can read the data at the same time. However, only one writer can access the data. And while the writer is writing, no other reader can be concurrently accessing. Otherwise, we'll have non-intuitive behavior. So either it is a single writer or it is multiple readers. Okay. So we'll never have multiple writers who are concurrently accessing. We'll never have a reader and a writer concurrently accessing, because we have already seen in the previous chapter what happens. It leads to correctness issues. Okay. So one simple example, let's say that we are setting two variables x and y equal to 1 in a piece of multi-threaded code, and initially they were 0 and 0. So from the outside, x should always be equal to y, but we allow a reader to read temporary state, it might read the value of x equal to 1 and y equal to 0, which of course is not something that you want, given that you want this entire block of code to execute atomically. So because of this atomic execution restriction, we have only one single writer at a time, that's what we can afford, or multiple readers. So there are of course variations, but we'll not get into that. We'll look at the basic structure. So in this case, we have a reader writer mutex. Again, the idea is the same, initialized to one. Then we have a mutex semaphore, which is initialized to one again. So they are different, we'll see in what way. And we have an integer called read count, not a semaphore, which is initialized to zero. This essentially indicates to the system how many readers are currently active. So the structure of a writer process is quite simple actually. It gets access to the read-write mutex. So it waits on the read-write mutex. Then it performs the write and it signals. So as far as the writer is concerned, the entire code is protected by a single lock, which is the read-write mutex. And clearly you can see that multiple writers cannot be active at the same time because they will stop at this point, the read-write mutex. The structure of a reader process in comparison is quite different. So what the reader does is that first the reader gets access to the mutex, right? So here what it does is it increments the read count because it is adding itself as a reader. If read count is equal to 1, which means that if it is the first reader, then it waits on the read-write mutex. Why does it do that? Well, the reason it does that is there could be a write that is happening in parallel. So it will wait for the write to finish. After that, once it gets access to the read-write mutex, this basically means that beyond this point, if the reader comes, there can be no concurrent writer. Okay, so this is something worth writing. Subsequently, what it is going to do is that it will leave the mutex, it will release the mutex. Okay. So that's what it will do. So actually, you know, there is one small correction in the sense that this if statement is basically this much. Right. So the signal mutex is essentially outside the if statement. The indent is not showing that. It is supposed to do that. So let us assume that for this wait, we have this signal over here. Okay, so this mutex is basically for two reasons. One is that since the read count is being updated, even if there are multiple concurrent readers, they should acquire this mutex primarily to increment read count. Okay, for no other reason. Well, for one other reason, which is this, but let's say two reasons. The first reason is that read count has to be updated, and given the fact that a shared variable is being updated, we will have to do it within the context of a lock. The other is that we need to throw out all writers. That's why the first reader, what that is going to do is that is basically going to see that, look, if it is the first reader, it will wait on the read-write mutex until it gets access to it. All right. And then this means that at the time after that, after it gets access to it, no writer can come in. Then the read operation is performed. And of course, let's say that while reader one is over here, another process reader two can again come in. Again, it will get access to the mutex. It will increment the read count. But at this point, read count equal to 1 will not hold because its read count will be 2. So it is not going to wait on the read-write mutex. It will just signal the mutex and again come in here and start reading. Subsequently, what will happen is that we will enter this piece of code where we will decrement the read count. So what did we do? The first time we incremented the read count. This time we will decrement the read count. And given the fact that read count is a shared variable, there is a need to actually protect it with a lock. So we protect it with a lock, we wait and signal on mutex, so we decrement read count. And if read count becomes equal to 0, which means that if let's say all the reads finish, then what we do is we release this lock. So we release the read write mutex such that if there are any waiting writers, they can come in. Okay. So what is the idea? So the idea over here is like this. Let me maybe slightly clean up the slide. The idea is that we have a read count variable. Given that it is a shared variable, it has to be incremented and decremented with the protection of a lock. So the lock that is protecting it is a mutex lock. Furthermore, if let's say I am the first reader, I need to displace the writer. So I need to displace a future writer. So consequently, I need to hang on to the read-write mutex such that if any writer shows up, it needs to wait. Subsequently, I do the reading, and at this point, parallel readers are allowed, in the sense we can have multiple readers that are reading in parallel. Then I decrement the read count. So there should be an underscore over here. And then I signal the read-write mutex if the read count reaches zero, which means there are no more readers left. Then any pending writers can start their job. So then the solution in the previous slide can result in a situation where a writer process never writes. The reason is, you just look at this, there is a fairness problem here. So let's say one reader enters, and before it has reached this point, another reader enters. So readers just keep on coming. So if readers keep on coming, this condition will actually never be equal to zero, because readers are just coming. There are always readers in the system. So which means that if a processor is waiting to write, it will just be waiting forever. So this is not fair for writers at all. So the second reader-writer problem is essentially a variation of this, which means once a writer is ready to write, no newly arrived reader is allowed to read, which means the starvation problem will not happen, because once a writer is ready, then the reader, any subsequent reader that arrives, needs to wait for the write to finish. So, of course, this also can lead to problems. So the problem is that in this case, there can be issues for the reader, because let's say if there is one writer, then there are a few readers, again a writer arrives. Since you'll always give preference to writers, you will not give preference to readers. As a result, this will lead to starvation, albeit for readers. So there are, of course, ways of taking care of this. One simple approach could be that we just maintain a queue, all right, and we just keep on inserting elements into the queue, and a reader is allowed to go forward if there is no writer ahead of it in the queue. If there is a writer ahead of it in the queue, the reader waits. So this would provide for fairness, as well as it would provide for parallelism as well. Furthermore, systems can also use the kernel for providing a reader-writer lock. But a reader-writer lock as such is a classic problem, and using a method of queuing the way that I described, it is possible to provide fairness as well. Now let's come to another variant, the third problem, the dining philosopher's problem. So the idea is simple, that there are five philosophers who are sitting on the table. They have their plates in front of them. Okay. So they do not interact with their neighbors, so they are philosophers, right? So they have two chopsticks on both sides of their plate. They need both the chopsticks to eat. So not one, they need both. So then what will happen is that they are all each given a bowl of rice, and essentially to eat rice, they will need chopsticks, but there is a possibility that you might have a deadlock, because if every philosopher chooses its rightmost chopstick, then this chopstick goes to this philosopher, this one goes to this, this chopstick goes here, this goes here, all right, and this goes here. So everybody just has one chopstick, they are waiting for their neighbor, and we have a circular wait situation where everybody is waiting and nobody is eating. And so this is, needless to say, it's a problem where, you know, the system as a whole is not making progress, and there is a deadlock. Clearly, if the system is making progress, and let's say one philosopher has two chopsticks, after he finishes his meal, he will put the two chopsticks back on the table. So in case of five philosophers, we can of course use a semaphore with a count of five, right? Or let's say use five semaphores initialized to one. That is, technically speaking, not going to solve the problem. So let's look at it. So what I can do is, I can wait for chopstick I, And then after getting chopstick I, I'll wait for chopstick I plus 1. No problem. Then I'll signal chopstick I and then signal chopstick I plus 1. But the main problem is it will lead to the issue that I had discussed in this slide, where everybody just picks up their ith chopstick, which means their leftmost or right, left chopstick or right one. So then what happens is everybody ends up with one chopstick each. So they can't eat because they need both the chopsticks. And also the system is not making any progress. Nobody is eating and nobody is also allowing others to eat by putting down the single chopstick that they have on the table such that his neighbor can pick it up. So that is also not happening. It's a classic stalemate deadlock situation. So let's provide a monitor solution to dining philosophers. So the monitor solution, let us define a state variable that has 5 entries and each entry can either be thinking, which means that a philosopher is thinking, it's not, he's not interested. Then next is hungry, means that the philosopher is interested, but doesn't have the chopsticks. And the philosopher is eating. Eating means both the chopsticks are there. And then we can define 5 condition variables in an array of the array called self, which has 5 entries. So one, the first function can be pickup. So pickup basically means I will set my own state. If I am the ith philosopher, ith philosopher sets its own state to hungry. It tests I. So if state I is not equal to eating, then it just waits on. So it sets a condition variable. It waits on itself. So let me explain the meaning of these two statements once again. So maybe cleaning the ink is due. So the test function, what it does is it basically says, or it tries to test if the ith process can actually pick up its two forks, right? So the ith process can pick up its two forks, then there is no issue. Then the state is set from hungry to eating. So this the test function will automatically do. So we'll take a look at it in the next slide. But I don't want to show that right now. The reason being that I would like to look at the abstraction. The abstraction is that we test the ith process. If the ith process can pick up both of its chopsticks, then its state is set to eating. And then we check that did the test function actually succeed. So if the state is equal to eating, no problem. We are successful, nothing needs to be done. So the pickup function is successful. However, if the pickup function is not successful, how will we get to know? State I will not be equal to eating, it will still be equal to hungry. Then what we do is we wait. And how do we wait? We wait on the conditional variable which is self I. So on this conditional variable, in the sense the process waits on itself, it waits for somebody else to wake it up. Okay, so it just waits. And similarly, the put down function, what that does is again invoked for process I. It first sets the state to thinking. Subsequently, it looks at the left and right neighbors, where the left neighbor is I plus, is actually I minus 1. But I minus 1 would come out to be the same as I plus 4 percentage 5. And the right neighbor would be I plus 1 percentage 5. So these are the two neighbors. It calls the test function on them. If any one of them can come in the sense if any one of them can pick up both of their chopsticks, then they are allowed. So then, of course, the next that is due is the test function. So the test function takes in a process ID as the argument. What it does is it takes a look at its left and right neighbors. So one neighbor is I plus 4 percentage 5. If the state of, let's say the left neighbor is not equal to eating, and the state of the right neighbor is also not equal to eating. So no, notice the ands over here, logical and. So the left neighbor is not equal to eating and the right neighbor is not equal to eating. which means that their chopsticks are on the table and state I is hungry, then it can easily pick up both the chopsticks, which is what it does. So what does it do? It sets the state to eating, which automatically implies that it has picked up both the chopsticks. And given that now the ith process can go through, it just signals the ith process. It just says self I dot signal. Okay. And so it signals the ith process. So the ith process, which was waiting over here, will wake up and finish its access. Of course, the initialization code is that at the beginning, all processes are thinking. So now the most important question is, does this code actually work? Well, yes, it does. The key element over here is the monitor. The monitor basically says, or let's say basically stops one important condition of a deadlock. So we will discuss deadlocks in detail in the next chapter. But deadlocks have an important condition, which is hold and wait, which means that I'm holding on to some resource and I'm waiting for some other resource. So in this case, I'm holding on to one chopstick and I'm waiting for another chopstick. This is what is precisely being stopped in this implementation. So in this implementation, either I have both the chopsticks or I have none, which means that in the monitor, only one of the processes can execute one of these functions at any given point of time. So if let's say one function comes in, the first function to come in, it would pick up both the chopsticks, so it is eating. Any subsequent chopstick, if you look at the code, it is simply not possible to hold on to a chopstick and wait for the other. Right? So just take a look at the states. So this should be a semicolon. So thinking means I am not interested. Hungry means I am interested, but I do not have any chopstick, right? So in this case, I have zero chopsticks with me. In this case, I have zero chopsticks with me. When I'm eating, I have two chopsticks. So it is never the case that actually I have one chopstick with me and I'm waiting for the other. So the deadlock, for a deadlock to happen, there are four conditions. One of them is hold and wait. So this hold and wait condition is not happening over here. That is why we will not have a deadlock. And furthermore, once a process has entered the system, sooner or later, somebody will signal it. All right. So it will get signaled and it will wake up. But of course, we are not discussing this in more detail, the fairness aspects and so on. But you are welcome to investigate. And this is not the only way of avoiding deadlocks. So another key condition of a deadlock is a circular wait. So we are also having a circular wait here, by the way, if we do not in this algorithm, in a naive implementation where let's say everybody just picks up the right fork, we'll have a circular wait. But the way that this can be broken is by breaking the symmetry, in the sense not allowing everybody to pick up the right fork, right? Some pick right, some left, such that will not have a circular wait. So you're welcome to look at other solutions on the web. Pretty much to avoid a deadlock, any solution has to stop one of the deadlock conditions. And there are two conditions here that are of relevance. One is circular wait and the other is hold and wait. So the monitor solution is attacking this specific aspect of a deadlock. So solution to the dining philosophers is very easy. We just call pick up and put down. So in this case, there is no deadlock. But as I have said, in this algorithm, fairness is an issue. Fairness basically means that starvation is an issue. So of course, fair dining philosopher protocols are there. So in this case, the reason starvation is an issue is because it is possible that let's say one of the philosophers waits and nobody wakes it up. Okay. In general, this will not happen. So what I was trying to say in the previous slide is that let's say in a randomized world, this is not expected to happen because somebody sooner or later nearby, if a neighbor gets it, it might pick it up. But what can happen is that you can have a set of philosophers here who are initially hungry, pick up the chopsticks, again put it down. Again, they wake up their neighbor. The neighbor will pick up the chopsticks, put it down. So this process will wake up this process, and then this process will wake up this process. So this sequence can keep on going forever. As a result, other processes may not get access to their chopsticks because nobody is waking them up. So that is why fairness is an issue. Okay, so it needs to be dealt with. So now let us discuss kernel synchronization in Windows. So on uniprocessor systems, as we have discussed in a previous chapter, Windows does mask interrupts. Multiprocessor systems, spin locks are used. Furthermore, Windows provides objects. So objects are, in the Windows world, placeholders for pretty much everything, which includes mutexes, semaphores, events, and timers. So first I'll simply discuss what is a timer. A timer is like, you can say that, look, I'm sleeping and the kernel should wake me up, let's say after 3000 seconds. Fair enough. Events. An event is like a condition variable, and a timer I've just discussed. And furthermore, for the dispatcher objects, we have synchronous and asynchronous variants. So the asynchronous variant can say whether an object is available or not, and a synchronous variable will lead to a synchronous variant will lead to the process blocking. All right. So basically, the mutex dispatcher object that Windows has, in this case, has two states, non-signaled and signaled. So non-signaled, in this case, the owner thread releases the mutex lock. So you go from non-signaled to signaled. And then when you acquire the mutex lock, the thread becomes non-signaled. Linux. So in Linux, it does provide everything that we discussed, semaphores, atomic integers, spin locks, reader-writer versions. Everything is provided. Even on single CPU systems, spin locks are there, but they are not encouraged because, of course, you can use the interrupt enable disable mechanism that can solve the same problem, and that is in a sense faster. So atomic variables, so there is a type of atomic variable called atomic T that Linux defines, and different architectures would implement atomic T in different ways. So there are some of the common operations which you will find in a Linux kernel, like atomic set, where you take the address, set it to a variable, atomic add, atomic sub, inc, atomic read. So the first four are basically read, modify, write operations. I'll explain what is an atomic read. So you can say that, look, a read is a read, right? It appears to happen instantaneously anyway. What is the need for an atomic variant of it? Well, what happens is that you might want to read 64 bits on a 32-bit system. In that case, what you need to do is that you need to read two memory words. If there are two memory words which are stored side by side, let's say memory word X and memory word Y, you are expected to capture a snapshot of both X and Y. So let's say it's 5 and 3. But what can happen is that after you read 5, an interrupt comes, and then you read the value of Y a long time later. At that point, 3 has changed to 4. Then this does not remain an atomic read anymore. So an atomic read is a mechanism where we read something which is more than the size of a memory word atomically in a few cycles. Right? The key word is atomic in the sense that the read appears to happen instantaneously. POSIX operating systems, Unix, Linux, Mac OS also support mutexes, semaphores, and condition variables. A POSIX mutex lock, like in pthread, so pthread is by far the most popular threading implementation on Linux. So there, using mutexes is quite easy. So you initialize a mutex, so you provide a pointer to it. Acquiring and releasing the mutex is simple. It is just mutex lock and mutex unlock. And of course, the argument is the pointer to the mutex data structure, which has been declared over here. That is all that needs to be done. Semaphores, well, POSIX operating systems provide two versions similar to pipes, named and unnamed. Similar to pipes, named semaphores can be used by unrelated processes, whereas unnamed semaphores cannot be. So, how do we use a semaphore? Well, that is simple. We include semaphore.h. We define a semaphore data structure, semt star sem. And this semaphore, by the way, has to be initialized. It is not like a mutex. So, we need to, similar to a shared memory segment, on Linux, we need to call the sem open function. So, the sem open function will create a semaphore. Since it's a named semaphore, we're giving it a name. We are asking the kernel to create the semaphore. These are the permissions of the semaphore, which means that these permissions are same as the file access permissions, which we will study later, sometime around chapter 15, 16. So then we will discuss this, but this is basically saying that it is giving any user, it is giving the same user or another user in the group or all the users read and write access to the semaphore. And the starting value, initialized value is 1. So any other process, as long as it has the permissions as defined by these, by this number, it can refer to the semaphore as sem and it can open the semaphore and use it. So the other process also needs to do the same. It also needs to open the semaphore and use it. Acquiring and releasing the semaphore is quite easy. We have a sem wait instruction and we have a sem post instruction, similar to wait and signal, what we have seen. So in this case, it is wait and post. Now let's come to unnamed semaphores. So in unnamed semaphores, we do not provide a name and we do not provide any file access permission. So these things are not provided. So we create a semaphore. We do not need to open it, but we need to initialize it. So we provide the address of the semaphore and we initialize it to 1. Acquiring the and releasing the semaphore is very simple, the same set of functions, sem wait and sem post. POSIX has support for condition variables as well. So unlike Java, POSIX operating systems that use C, C++ for most of their programs, they do not have the notion of monitors. So monitors primarily came after Java came in. Nevertheless, POSIX condition variables are possible to define, but they are always associated with a mutex that protects the count, internal count of the condition variable. So what we need to do is we need to define both a mutex as well as a condition variable with pthread mutex t and pthread quant t. So the first thing that we do over here is that we initialize the mutex and we initialize the conditional variable as well. So if let's say thread is waiting for a condition a equal to b to be true, so then what it does is that it first acquires the associated mutex. As long as a is not equal to b, it waits on the conditional variable. And of course, given that A and B are shared variables, you need to provide the address of the mutex as well, because it will use this mutex to internally provide mutual exclusion. And once the conditional, the condition is true, it will exit the wait function and will again come to the while loop. Again, if the condition is not true, again, it will go to the conditional wait function. And finally, when it is done, we release the mutex. Similarly, for signaling, we have exactly the same idea. We first lock the mutex, then we signal the variable, and then we release the mutex. So in this case, of course, the signaling condition here is A equal to B. This is what your waiting thread will also detect when it is waiting. So this is not as simple as the mechanism that we described, because what we described was something that modern avatars of languages implement. So, but pthread does have support for condition variables. Of course, separately a mutex needs to be defined, right? But this is pretty much the way that it works. So in this case, of course, one sticky issue is the issue with the mutex. So many students typically ask, what is the need for a mutex, right? Why not have a weight and signal without a mutex? Well, so much of this has to do with the fact that C and C++ are compiled languages. So they do not have the kind of visibility that, let's say, for example, Java has, which is an interpreted language. So what the quantweight function would do is that internally it would first release the mutex. It will first internally release the mutex. It will keep the process waiting over here. After that, after the mutex is released, what will happen is that any other thread that is signaling, that will find the mutex to be free. So then it can enter. Otherwise, you know, once it is waiting, you can argue that, look, the mutex has been locked, so no other signaling thread can enter and acquire the mutex. That doesn't happen. The reason is that the moment we enter quantwait, the library would internally release the mutex. Subsequently, a signaling thread will come in, and the signaling thread will finish its job. Then it will unlock the mutex. Then this thread will check for the condition, then it will reacquire the mutex. So what happens is, a lot of this is done to ensure that, one, the waiting thread genuinely blocks, and also the mutex acts like kind of a rendezvous, in the sense that it forces the waiting thread to start after all the writes by the signaling thread have been written to memory, such that when the waiting thread starts, it immediately gets the state that the signaling thread has actually written. Right, so there are some memory consistency issues and process issues. Because of that, this complicated mechanism is required. Java synchronization, so Java provides everything. So in terms of synchronization, Java is heaven. It provides monitors, reentrant locks, right? So locks that can be even taken by the same thread twice, semaphores and condition variables. So every Java object by default, so every object in Java by default has a lock associated with it. So within an object, if we declare a method with a synchronized keyword, this means that the calling thread must own the lock for the object. So in the sense, the object becomes a monitor. All right. So even if there is a single method that is declared as synchronized, then at least for all the synchronized methods, the object becomes a monitor. If the lock is owned by another thread, the calling thread must wait for the lock to be released. And locks are, of course, released when the owning thread exits the synchronized method. So we will never get to see it. Right? So the good thing is that we will have an object in Java. What we need to do is, we just need to, before the function name, we put in synchronized. Okay? Subsequently, if let's say you do it for three functions, this object becomes a monitor. So we don't need any lock and unlock call, because the moment we exit a function, the monitor is expected to be released. So how would we, for example, implement the bounded buffer problem in Java? So what we'll do is, we'll define a public class called bounded buffer. It will take an object of type E. So here the type is being provided as an argument. Let the buffer size be equal to 5. So we'll define an array of, again, type E. So the type is not being specified. So one advantage of this is, we can create an array of integers, floating points, doubles, you name it. So this will be an array of buffers. So the bounded buffer class, initially count will be 0, in 0, out 0. And the buffer array will be created. So the producers will call one method, consumers will call one more method, but both are synchronized. So they act as a monitor. Insert, same monitor code. So figure 7.11, you can take a look at it in the book. But essentially the idea is that insert is very simple. You just insert something into the bounded buffer queue, and remove is just, you just remove. So it's the same way. It's like a regular queue access, nothing great about it. And the reason it works is because it's a monitor. What does a monitor ensure? A monitor ensures that when somebody is calling insert, no other thread can call remove. It needs to wait for the insert thread to go away. Then the other thread will enter the remove function and remove an entry. So it is like protecting all the functions within an object with the same lock. So Java synchronization. So whenever a thread tries to acquire a lock for an object, it is put in an internal queue that is maintained by the library and the virtual machine. We don't get to see that. And then in a first come first serve basis, the thread is acquired the object. So when a thread calls wait, it releases the lock for the object. The state of the thread gets blocked and the thread is again placed on the wait set of the object. So this is similar to what we have been seeing with those monitors and condition variables, if you would recall, in the previous chapter, where we have an entry set in the set in the sense that the threads come in, they wait. So this is like external waiting. Again, refer to the previous chapter, otherwise you will not be able to understand. This is external waiting. So Java maintains one queue for that. And this is again internal waiting. So Java maintains one more queue for that, right, associated with a monitor. So basically, when you call wait, you are waiting for some sort of a condition to get true. And how does a thread get notified? So instead of the signal function that we were using in the previous chapter, here we will simply call notify. So an arbitrary thread T will be selected from the wait set and it will execute. So of course, it's not that arbitrary in the sense that Java does ensure that there is no starvation. So there is a notion of priority as well as a first come first serve basis. So T is then moved from the wait set to the entry set. So we were actually seeing something very similar to this in the previous chapter. So I'm not discussing this in great detail. And then we set the state of T from block to runnable. So it comes to the entry set and then it runs. So now T can now compete for the lock to check if the condition it was waiting for it is now true or not. So again, the bounded buffer problem with wait and notify. So in this case, for the producing function, we have an insert which is synchronized. As long as the count is equal to the buffer size, so as long as the count of the number of elements in the queue is equal to the buffer size, we cannot insert a new element. So what we will do is we will wait. So this again is an internal wait. It is not an external wait. Okay. And of course, it is possible that a thread can be woken up because something catastrophic happened with the thread other than a regular wake up. So in this case, Java has a mechanism of throwing what is called an interrupted exception. So of course, if this is thrown, it's a catastrophic event and we might also want to terminate the program. So I'm not getting into that. Then what is done is that once sufficient buffer space is available, we set in buffer. We have two pointers. It's like one of those circular queue kind of implementations with an in and an out pointer. So buffer in is set equal to item. In is equal to in plus 1 percentage buffer size. So if you would recall, we have, this is like a circular queue where we have an in pointer and an out pointer. Okay. Well, I think it would have been a better idea if I would have drawn them in a reverse way. So let's say my out is over here, my in is over here. If I want to insert a new element, I insert it over here, I increment in, and the new element is inserted over here. All right. And of course, since there is a wraparound, because it's a circular queue, we have in is equal to in plus 1 percentage buffer size. And finally, we increment the count. And then we do a notify. So who is this notifying? It is notifying any of the threads that is waiting. And why would it be waiting? It would be waiting because it would have found the buffer to be empty. So it will simply notify. So as you can see, the code over here is very, very similar to what we had discussed in the previous chapter. Similarly, consumers will call this method, which is also exactly the same as we have been seeing. So they will call a remove method, where we will read an object from the queue and return it. So of course, people who are new to this Java format would see that it is also taking the type of an object as an argument. So this is known as generics. It's actually a good idea. So even C++ has this. It is called a template. So the reason is that, look, if you are providing a buffer functionality, then it should be able to store all kinds of objects. But at compile time, you don't know which object it is storing, right? So what you do is that you take in the type of the object and dynamically you generate code when you actually see what kind of object it is taking. Now coming to the synchronization, this is how it would look. So since I'm consuming, I'll first check the count. If the count is zero, there is nothing to consume. So then I wait for somebody to wake me up. And who would wake you up? The producer will wake you up when it has added an entry. Anytime that I wait in Java, I can have an interrupted exception in the sense that somebody might just interrupt the thread, interrupt the waiting process, which is not the producer. So as I said, that is a catastrophic event and we need not discuss it right now. Books on Java have more details. Now when I want to remove, again, as I said, it is a simple circular queue implementation with out over here and in over here. So I simply do out equal to out plus 1% buffer size. So I remove the next entry and I decrement the count and I notify. So who am I notifying? I'm notifying any producers which are waiting over here. If the count is equal to the buffer size, so then they would be waiting. So I'm notifying any waiting producers and I'm returning the item. Quite similar to what we have seen. Java has reentrant locks. So reentrant locks, what they do is that just in case they get interrupted or something happens, there is a finally block which ensures that the lock is released in case there is an exception occurs in this try block. So what happens is that you can have all kinds of exceptions. You might divide by zero, you might access a null pointer, somebody might ask you to terminate the process, doesn't matter, terminate the thread. So whatever is the case, before you actually handle the exception, you will execute the code in this finally block. And here what you will do is you will unlock the lock. Okay, so this is a typical example of the way that a lock is used in Java. So with this mechanism, it ensures that regardless of whatever happens, if you have taken the lock, you are duty bound to unlock it. Java semaphore, same idea. We just define a semaphore. We provide the starting count. Two functions, acquire and release. Absolutely similar to the way we had in C, C++. Java condition variables. So here again, similar to C, C++, every condition variable is associated with a reentrant lock. So we create a lock first and we create a condition variable first. But in this case, the connection is more explicit. So we use the lock to create a new condition, which is convar. And of course, the condition variable internally uses the lock to provide the service, provide the condition variable service. So a thread waits by calling the await method, await method, and signals by calling the signal method. So it's instead of wait, it is await and signal, right? So here also we declare a condition variable in pairs, in the sense a lock and its associated condition variable. So the example of a condition variable in Java would look like this. So let's say that we have five threads numbered 0 to 4. There's a shared variable turn, which is indicating which thread's turn it is. Threads call the do work function when they wish to do some work. If it's not their turn, they wait. If it's their turn, they do something for some time. When they complete it, they notify the thread whose turn is next. So the necessary data structure, well, we have a lock. We have condition variables. And furthermore, for each condition variable, all of them use the same lock, which is defined as LOCK, small locks, and with them we associate the five condition variables. That's the way we initialize. So the Java code for the do work function, this is the way it would look, where the argument is the thread number. So similar to C++, the first thing that we do is that we acquire the lock. So acquiring the lock is as simple as just calling the lock function. Subsequently, we have a try catch block, which means if there is any exception, you come over here. But before leaving the function, you unlock. So this part is again trivial. So what we need to look at is this. So if it's not my turn, then wait until I am signaled, right? So if it's not my turn, I just wait. So if thread number is not equal to turn, then I go to my associated condition variable and I just wait. I call the await function. Otherwise, I do some work and I signal the next thread, which is turn plus 1 percentage 5, and I simply go and I signal it, okay? So of course here fairness could be an issue, because the next thread, which is turn plus 1, might actually never show up, but other waiting threads might wait forever. Nevertheless, this is a solution if, let's say, all the threads are guaranteed to show up in a certain window of time. But this is exactly what I would do. For a simple implementation, I'm not saying it's totally correct or efficient or fair, but this for a simple implementation is what I would do. But if I care about correctness and fairness, right, and also if, let's say, I want a thread to be able to execute this function as soon as possible, then of course I will write a fairer version of this. There are a few alternative approaches to writing parallel code, such as transactional memory, OpenMP, and functional programming. So in transactional memory, just a quick broad idea, what you do is that if you want a set of code to execute atomically, if there's a large amount of code and you want to execute atomically, one problem with lock and unlock will be that, let's say, consider there are two threads. Both of them are executing this piece of code, but they're accessing totally different pieces of data. So one of the common examples that is given in this case is that of a bank account. So consider that, you know, I have this function, void update. So this is the bank account. So let's say this is the bank account and this is the balance. Okay. So in this case, what I can do is, So this is what you want to do. So of course, this piece of code over here has a problem that it is not thread safe, because two different threads can be running the same code on the same account, and that will lead to a race condition. So we typically place a lock over here and an unlock over here. But what is the real likelihood of two threads accessing the same bank account at the same time? How many times while accessing the bank you are also withdrawing money from the ATM? Very rare, right? Can happen, but very rare. In general, you will have millions of users who are accessing their own accounts and the data is totally disjoint. So what you do is, at that point, you use transactional memory. You have a begin transaction and you have an end transaction. So then what happens is that the hardware or software layer basically checks if between two threads there is any overlap in the data or not. If the data that is being accessed, in this case the bank accounts, if they are disjoint bank accounts with no relationship to each other, it allows this piece of code to be executed in parallel. Unlike locks, it's not a performance killer. If, let's say, I were to put this piece of code within a lock and unlock, regardless of the code, only one thread will be able to do it. So even if I have a million threads in the system, I'll be executing this piece one after the other. But transactions will allow parallelism. They will only sequentialize when the same account is being accessed. Then you do it one after the other. Otherwise, if they are different accounts, they can be updated in parallel. So that is the great advantage of transactional memory. OpenMP, we have discussed OpenMP earlier also when we discussed some examples. So OpenMP also provides a lock and unlock. So this is called hash pragma OMP critical. Critical means critical section. What is a critical section? It is the code between a lock and an unlock. So in this case, it is being demarcated with these curly brackets. So we have count plus equal to value, same as update my account balance. Finally, functional programming. So those who haven't, who do not have an experience of functional programming, so they are different kinds of, it's a different kind of a language, different kind of paradigm. Something like Erlang or Scala or OCaml are functional programs. So in this case, what happens is that threads really do not have state. So they do not maintain state like they do not maintain in a, maintain it on a heap or something. And variables are treated as immutable. Immutable means unchangeable. This means that if you set the value of a variable, let's say to 0, you can't set it to 1. If you set it to 1, it will become a new version of X. So functional programming as of today, there is a language called F# by Microsoft, which has many functional features. So they are getting popular in this space, but you know, this is, it's just starting, so nothing much can be said as of now. All right, so this brings us to the end of chapter 7. All right, so we will discuss more about deadlocks later, in later chapters. But as of now, chapter 6 and 7 have pretty much covered almost all aspects of programming, both from a theoretical side as well as a practical side, insofar as synchronization primitives and synchronization operations are concerned.